In my past videos on Silent Hill, I analyzed characters and settings that are obviously drenched with meaning. For this video, I am attempting to analyze something that is both seemingly innocuous and also seemingly less interesting than the subjects I have already tackled. What is so special about red squares? Just because the Silent Hill series is laden with visual metaphors doesn't mean everything has a special meaning to it. What's worse is that a red square can symbolize pretty much anything, whereas a character like Pyramid Head is so specific and unique in his design that he only has a few viable interpretations. Why focus on the save points from Silent Hill 2 instead of something else, like the Order or maybe some of the talismans like Flaros and the Seal of Metatron? When I started making connections between the psychoanalytic theories of Carl Jung, Sigmund Freud, and Silent Hill's mythos, I discovered a vast realm of unconscious territory yet to be explored. There was a density to Silent Hill's subtext that went undiscovered for 20 years, of which only one element was psychoanalysis. If Hiroyuki Owaku, Silent Hill's lead scenario writer, was inspired by psychoanalysis, what were his other inspirations? Well, in researching the game's mythology, I came across a subject that was not only of interest to Owaku, but also to the aforementioned Carl Jung. That subject was alchemy, and in alchemy, there is a concept that might help explain the meaning of the red squares. Before I explain alchemy's influence on Silent Hill, I feel it's best to take a step back and list what we know for certain about the red squares. In Silent Hill 2, when James looks at the red square in the well, he says the following: "Looking at this makes me feel like someone's groping around inside my skull. It gives me a weird feeling." These red squares are not limited to the save points either. They cover the mouths of the nurses in both Silent Hill 2 and Silent Hill 3. When a fan asked the former creature designer for Silent Hill, Masahiro Ito, why the squares cover the mouths of the nurses, Ito responded by saying, "It has something to do with nine red squares." The nine squares he refers to are, of course, the final save point in Silent Hill. According to the Silent Hill 2 guidebook, the final save point has to do with James's memories no longer being repressed. Finally, there are other uses of squares in the Silent Hill series, specifically in Silent Hill 3. There are squares hanging above corpses, squares on the back of wheelchairs, and some of these squares depict the mouth and ears of Alessa, except all these squares aren't red. That's about all we know for certain. What we still don't know is why Owaku was keen on using squares and why he made them red. Before I attempt my explanation, allow me to repeat. The symbolism of a square is so vague that it can mean everything or nothing. There will be viewers who think I'm reading too much into the squares, or not enough. What I'd like to ask my viewers to do this time is not focus so much on what I believe the red squares symbolize. Rather, focus on the material I cite leading up to my conclusion. Even if my ultimate conclusion is wrong, I believe I have unearthed aspects of Silent Hill that almost nobody has noticed before, and those aspects are as intriguing, if not more than, my overall hypothesis. Let us now bring up the subject of alchemy. Alchemy has a long, complicated history that cannot be summarized without sacrificing crucial details. For now, I will have to ask the alchemy enthusiasts out there to forgive my oversimplifications, as I am doing them for the sake of time and clarity. Prior to the Enlightenment era and scientific chemistry, alchemy was the practice of trying to transform lesser elements into greater elements. For example, there was a belief that one could find a way to transmutate lead, a lesser metal, into gold, a greater metal. The ultimate goal of alchemy was to find the philosopher's stone, a supposedly perfect substance that could turn all base metals into gold and give immortality to those who weld it. In order to find the philosopher's stone, one would have to blend all the correct elements into a single brew and solidify it. But herein lies an important question. Where did the concept of the philosopher's stone come from? Why would a stone give immortality to those who ate a small piece of it? Well, the quote-unquote science of alchemy was based on philosophical assumptions. The ancient alchemists projected their own psychic processes onto outside objects. For example, the belief that gold is of greater value than lead. One philosophical assumption was that the human soul would transmutate through experience, much like a metal would supposedly transmutate. If the philosopher's stone was a perfect substance that could grant immortality, maybe the soul could become a perfect entity. The journey to find the philosopher's stone in reality was reflected in the psychology of its seeker. It was as much an internal journey as it was external, and only the pure of heart, could attain both. In case you didn't notice, there are several references to alchemy in the Silent Hill series. In my research, I discovered that several alchemical symbols populate the inner ring of the Order's crest, the Halo of the Sun. The symbols refer to various ingredients such as magnesium, beeswax, and the aforementioned gold. For a time, these were the only concrete references to alchemy I noticed. However, by pure chance, I discovered a YouTube user named Reinstall Paul, who put out a series of videos on Silent Hill less than a year ago. In one of his videos, he cited several references to alchemy that I would have never noticed, one of which was a picture of the green lion devouring the sun. According to Paul, this picture marks the halfway point of the seven-step alchemical process, as well as the midpoint in the hero's journey. On top of this picture appears halfway through the first Silent Hill game. The seven steps of alchemy are reflected in the symbols of the seven Olympian spirits. These symbols appear on the TV screens in the Silent Hill Mall. Finally, I'd like to refer back to how the alchemical process is as much about perfecting the soul as it is about perfecting matter. Paul pointed out that the character of Harry's last name, Mason, means stone. Harry is on a journey to find what is most precious to him, his daughter Cheryl. To do this, he has to go through hell and back to find her. His journey is as much internal as it is external. In going through hell to find his daughter, he embodies the perfect father. As fascinating as this is to me, and I hope to many of you, the mystery of the red squares still lingers. Now that the basics of alchemy have been established, we can address the squares properly. There is a concept in alchemy known as squaring the circle. Several centuries ago, there was a mathematical puzzle discovered to be impossible. Using only a straight edge and a compass, one must create a square with the same internal area as a circle. Nowadays, we can do this with the use of calculators and irrational numbers, but back then, it was impossible. Since then, the phrase squaring the circle has taken on a separate meaning for doing the impossible. In regards to alchemy, like I said before, squaring the circle has a dual meaning for the soul as well as for the material world. Let us first describe how one would actually square the circle in the material world. In alchemy, there is a concept known as the prima materia, which translates to first matter. Supposedly, at the beginning of time, before anything existed, there was only a dark void. Void of nothingness. The void was the prima materia from which everything was created. It is the infinite, the endless. It is the chaos out of which order is created. The circle symbolizes the prima materia. If one wanted to square the circle, one would have to create something out of the prima materia. An old Christian assumption was that God's light mixed with the darkness, and from that came the four classic elements: earth, water, fire, and air. Simply, to square the circle alchemically means to create something out of nothing, an impossibility. But again, there is an external meaning as well as an internal meaning when it comes to alchemy. According to Carl Jung, squaring the circle in psychological terms referred to bringing something from unconsciousness into consciousness. Think about it. If the beginnings of alchemy involved creating something material, something ordered, out of chaos, out of nothingness, one could do the same thing internally. One could bring something that is unconscious into conscious territory. One could find something in the black, mysterious void of our unconscious and bring it into the light. This takes the form of introspection. Now, usually, introspection can be quite painful, but quite necessary. In order to grow on a spiritual level, one must identify the parts of ourselves that are undesirable and find ways to eradicate them. Carl Jung referred to this process as the confrontation with the shadow. For example, when you were a child, maybe you were chastised for stealing cookies from the cookie jar. In order to grow, you had to identify your sinful tendencies towards immediate gratification and greed and bring them under your control. Once again, bringing your unconscious tendencies into consciousness. Squaring the circle. There is a common alchemical phrase that goes as such, instaquilinis invenitur. This translates to, in filth it will be found. To Jung and the alchemists, this meant that what you want to find most will be located where you least want to look. In my opinion, I don't think there is a better phrase out there to summarize the Silent Hill narrative. Harry Mason found his daughter by going to hell and confronting Incubus. Heather suffers a similar fate in Silent Hill 3. As for James Sunderland in Silent Hill 2, he has to go through hell to remember what he did to his wife, to bring the unconscious memory back into consciousness. Now let me remind you of two things we know for certain about the red squares. One is that upon looking at the first red square, James says looking at it makes him feel like someone is groping around inside his skull. The nine squares at the end of the game represent James's memories no longer being repressed. Based on all the information I presented, I can only assume that the squares represent James trying to remember what he did to his wife. Every time he comes across a square, he gets closer to bringing that unconscious memory back into consciousness. In other words, James is trying to square his circle, to make conscious something unconscious. As for why the square is red, and why it covers the mouth of the bubblehead nurse, Masahiro Ito gives us a hint. The meaning of the head of the bubblehead nurse is representative of suffocated Mary's swollen head under the pillow. One can deduce that the reason why the red square is in front of the nurse's face is because the forces of Silent Hill are trying to remind James that he suffocated his wife with a pillow. Red symbolizes death. The reason why the red squares are on the face of the nurse in Silent Hill 3 is probably because Heather is trying to remember what happened to Alessa and how Lisa Garland, a nurse, looked after her. Or maybe Alessa's memories are trying to be expressed in Silent Hill's other world. After all, the squares featuring Alessa's mouth and ears could be memories of her insanity and pain trying to find expression. As for why a red square would cover the mouth, well, what better way is there to give form to one's unconscious thoughts than to express them through speech? Covering the mouth is symbolic for repressing something seeking expression. It is only when the thought isn't being repressed that it might be displayed in all its horror, whether it's a bleeding ear, a shrieking mouth, or James suffocating his wife through a square television screen. Thanks so much for watching. If you liked this video, make sure to hit that like button. That helps the channel out a lot. Make sure you go and check out Reinstall Paul's Silent Hill series. I'll link to it in the description box below. Finally, if you want to see more content like this, please consider checking out one of the other videos in my series on Silent Hill Mythology.